These two guys drew the short straw, and today they're talking with me about the HO Studley Tool Chest. Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop, sponsored by patrons of Matt's Basement Workshop. Audience-funded support through Patreon.com. Sign up today at patreon.com/Matt's Basement Workshop. On today's episode, we're talking with Don Williams and Narayan Nair, all about H.O. Studley, the man, his tool chest, and of course the exhibit coming up in May 2015. Now, just as a fair warning, I want to let everybody know that this was a Skype-recorded video and audio, so there's going to be some fluctuations. The guys look amazing. I'm in front of the camera, and we all know how bad that looks. But anyways, let's get on with it. Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. It's something a little bit unusual today. As you can see, I'm kind of joined by a couple of guests here. I have Narayan and Don Williams joining me from in front of the Studley Tool Chest. And that's a pretty impressive tool chest you guys got back there. In fact, actually, if you guys could just completely get out of the way, I'd like to have a conversation just with the tool chest.
No.
Okay. I knew there was going to be a little hitch in there, something like that. So let's do this. Let's get right into the conversation. We've got a number of questions that came in. And the first thing I want to do is, of course, I want to talk about the event itself. Coming up in May, there's going to be an exhibit. Can you tell us a little bit about the exhibit?
Sure. The tool chest, its contents, the workbench underneath it now, and some other materials will be on exhibit in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, which is only about 20 minutes away from the Handworks event, which many folks will be at. And for 3 days only, the tool chest and workbench will be on exhibit, open to the public. You can go to the website, studleytoolchestexhibit.com, and it will talk about the experience. I'm really trying to design a very intimate experience for the attendee and viewer. It's not going to be a whole horde of thousands of people at once. There's only 50 people go in for an hour, and they get to spend that whole hour with the collection and photograph it and look at it and probably drool.
I'm sure there'll be plenty of that.
it's actually in the sort of whimsical, but not, I've actually scheduled in cleaning time for the case at the end of every hour. I've set aside 5 minutes to clean the case because people are going to want to have their noses right up against it. They'll only be, you know, a few inches away from it to begin with, but that's never close enough, I guess.
Right. Well, you know, when we were in in North Carolina, I was joking around with you about it'd be really cool if we could figure out a way to track the eye movement of where people are looking, and just out of curiosity, where do they start, where do they finish, and all that other stuff. So maybe we can get that with the nose prints before you clean it. Maybe you could kind of track those.
I'll see if I can put some sort of a track, you know, a fluorescing spray or something, and take a photograph. See what we can.
We're also going to be listening to people's heartbeats and tracking them via satellite on the way.
Oh, that's awesome! That's amazing. Now, the other thing that this is going to correspond with is the release of the book. Now, the book is coming out just before the exhibit, or about the same time.
What I understand is the book's coming out about a month or 6 weeks before the exhibit. I don't know the exact date, but it'll be out, so if you've made the order when it first is announced, it should be in your hands well before you come, and you'll be, you know, anybody who has the book and is coming to the exhibit will be well primed with, you know, a sense of what this is all about. It's not just cheesecake photos, although there are plenty of those, but it really is an attempt to seriously dissect the toolbox and its contents, the workbench, in a lot of different contexts about, you know, where does this fit in woodworking lore? What is this history? Some sort of cut and dried. These are the tools. These are how they're assembled. This is the toolbox. Here's how it was made, that sort of thing.
And Studley, a lot of scholarships on Studley itself.
He's an enigmatic character, but a fascinating guy from what we know about him. And There's probably going to be more there than has ever been compiled about him by anybody ever before. So
now, of course, there's going to be tons of amazing pictures in here. Norin, that's where you come in, where you were taking the pictures?
Yeah, doing the photography. Been at this for 5 years now.
Yeah. As soon as I asked Chris for whether he was interested in the book. My second question is, can Narayan be the photographer?
So, Narayan, I imagine there's going to be some big fans of the pictures that are there. Now, do you plan on signing a lot of those pictures or pointing out things in it? Because I'm sure there's going to be the one or two individuals that are like, when you were looking at this, what was running through your mind as you saw that through the lens?
Well, hopefully the picture will capture that. But
right.
No, I mean, we have more pictures than we need for the book.
Okay.
And I think the monumental task in front of us is choosing the ones that I think convey the experience of being in front of the chest as well as all of its constituent elements the best.
And again, I know from a lot of the people that I've been talking with and some of them that sent in the questions that we're just going to get into in a second here, they are so envious of you guys. It's a level of envy that like borders on obscene to disgusting. So there's some people that really want to be in your shoes. So I'd watch yourselves while you were there from what it sounds like.
Yeah, it's an enviable, I mean, it's a real honor, I think, to be working on this project.
I was just talking to somebody today who encountered it for the first time, and it said, you still realize how special it is. I've been here probably close to 30 days over 6 years now. Yeah, it's still mighty special.
That's awesome. So let's do this. Let's go ahead and talk about H.O. Studley himself. As you said, a lot of people, we don't know much about him, or at least people that are familiar with the tool chest aren't familiar with him. Can you talk a little bit about what his background is?
Can I talk a little about it?
Well, can we condense it a little?
I'll see you tomorrow.
Okay, no problem.
He was born in Lowell, Mass. in 1838. Grew up in a family of millwrights and ingenious mechanic type people. We don't know exactly how he was trained, but he was listed in various times as a machinist, as a millwright, as a window and sash maker. And then finally, as he was approaching 30 years old, he alighted in the piano and organ trade.
Okay.
And he worked there for the rest of his life for 50 years. And while we don't have any kind of record of his day-to-day activities, we can see from what little public record there is about him, he was highly admired and regarded as they would quote, an ingenious mechanic. He loved detailed, intricate, interlocking, complex things, which would make him a perfect fit for somebody who worked on piano and organ keyboards, which is what he did.
Okay.
He worked until he was in his 80s. He retired at the age of 81, to the best of our knowledge. He had the tool chest up until he retired. And so, again, while we don't have, you know, I keep looking in used bookstores for the autobiography, How I Did It, by Henry O. Studley, but I haven't found that one just yet. But he was an amazing artisan and designer, and he clearly had an eye for design. He clearly had a passion for precision work. We could say that was a compelling and compulsive passion. I don't know, because there's really no part of this that is haphazard.
Okay.
So that's sort of what we know. He died in 1926, and his obituaries all made note of the fact that he was so highly esteemed as a craftsman. And oh, by the way, he had this amazing tool cabinet that everybody just fell over in front of. So,
okay, well, that actually leads into another question that came up was, when with his tool chest, when he was alive, or apparently maybe towards the end there, was this like something that people came around to see quite a bit?
We are definitely left with that impression.
Okay.
That he was renowned for this tool cabinet and for his facility as what would be called an action man or a voicing man, the guy who actually built the guts of the piano. But there was reference in the last year of his work that this tool cabinet was, you know, of admiration by everybody who encountered it. So it was fairly well known. And in fact, both in the book and in the exhibit, that we'll actually use a copy of the periodical that profiled him with the only known picture of him with his tool cabinet and workbench. And it is speaking of him in glowing terms. So clearly, a lot of people saw it, and a lot of people thought it was as fantastic as we do.
Oh, that's amazing. Now, there was one question that came in from Kyle, and I'm sure the answer is a yes, but he was wondering if there's any other known tool chests from Mr. Studley, and what do they look like? Are they as detailed, if we have any idea at all?
We don't have any other tool chests. We do have some architectural millwork and a couple of fireplace surrounds that he built. They're stylistically very different, but they are still exquisite workmanship. And again, they will be featured in the book. I think we had it on a website a couple weeks ago. You know, it's on Chris's site. I think it was Henry Studley Trim Carpenter was the name of the post. But we do have a couple of extant examples of his workmanship outside of the tool case.
Okay. And of course, there are pictures of that that will be appearing in there. I'm assuming you guys had a chance to travel around, have camera, go visit anything Studley.
I put a lot of miles on my truck in the last 5 years. Yeah.
That's excellent. And I imagine, Noreen, that you were in quite a few different positions getting these pictures. I think I saw one or two camera poses where you definitely were, didn't look very comfortable being in those positions to snap a good shot.
Yeah. The room in which the chest is located has a number of immovable objects and is pretty constrained. So some of the photos required me to get into the ceiling or sort of do gymnastics. We've got some photos of me, I guess, doing that. But
I was just going to ask. I was hoping there was some behind the scenes footage of that.
Yeah. I think, you know, we've documented the process as well as the artifacts.
One of my favorite pictures is there's a ladder, and all you see in Orion's feet, and the rest of him is up above the ceiling.
Now, how many times were you in danger of something falling on you, like especially the tool chest itself? I can imagine that would not be a good thing.
Zero. We're very, very careful with the tool chest. You know, even if we touch it here, we got the gloves, and we treat it with all the respect it deserves.
Excellent. That's good to hear, and I'm sure the owner definitely appreciates that too. Let's move on to some of the other questions that came in were about the actual construction of the chest itself. What was the wood, and is there anything really unique about the materials that were used in it, or even the joinery of the chest itself?
The basic box is made of Cuban mahogany with fairly typical joinery. There's nothing extraordinary about that. But the way he infilled it with all the partitions and the lifting panels and the way all the parts interlock, it's almost like an unfolding jewel cabinet.
Okay.
And given that, the level of attention, and Ryan and I were both talking that there's this one portion sort of right in the center of the whole mass, and we could just sit here on the chair and look at that for hours at a time because it is so brilliantly conceived and designed as a piece of art. So unlike a really nicely done tool cabinet, this is a nicely done tool cabinet that is a spectacular piece of art.
Another question that came in is Scott was asking, he said he noticed in pictures that he's seen that the dovetails in the main tool chest seem to be oriented in the wrong direction to make the use of the mechanical advantage of the joint. Do you have any idea why this was? I mean, another question that he ended up asking also was this the type of tool chest that would Mr. Studley travel around with this? I can't imagine somehow him turning to his spouse and being like, well, I got to move across town. I'm bringing the whole chest with me. I'm just going to load it in the back of the trunk there, and I'll be back in a little while.
Well, in his 50-year career in the piano trade, he only worked for two companies, so he wasn't moving around much.
Okay.
We also had noticed the idiosyncrasy of where the dovetails were. But at the same time, it would have hung from the back, or did hang from the back, like many of its contemporaries with French cleats. So there was never any expectation that corner joinery was going to contribute anything to its stability while it was hanging. It was always designed to do that. The general form of this tool case is well known in the time of industrial America of the late 19th century. So while Studley's may have been the finest tool cabinet of this ilk, there were thousands, if not tens of thousands, of other tool cabinets of the same general design.
Okay. Now, so since this hung on the wall, obviously it can fold up. Did it stay open the way that we see it typically, where it's wide open? Or would it be something like at the end of the day, as he's done, he would close it up or cover it or something? Is there anything like that that would protect the tools as he wasn't in the shop?
Not a lot.
It, yeah. the fact that there's a combination bank safe vault on it suggests to me that he took advantage of it and locked it up every night.
Gee, I don't know why. There's just a few tools in there.
Yeah, there's nothing in here that would tempt any reasonable person, I think. Well, yeah, we have them all counted. We know where they are. If something's missing, you can spot it right away.
Okay.
To just build on that a bit, the strike plate for the lock has actually been removed because nobody knows the combination to the lock, and it would really suck to accidentally close it and not be able to open it up again.
Yeah, I don't see anybody wanting to come in there with a pry bar, or at least anybody that has any idea what it is. Of course, there's always the one person's like, I got a pry bar out in the car. I'll be right back in and help you guys out. I'm sure that somebody would be willing to do that.
Yeah.
Suddenly had a low jack on it, though.
All right, so another question that came in was from Alan, and I think this one probably is pretty self-evident, but he was wondering, you know, was the tool chest just for storage at the end of the day, or was he constantly pulling tools out and putting them back in as he worked? And along the lines of that, looking at it in the pictures that we've seen, and I'm sure the pictures that we will see, everything looks like it's so snug in there. I mean, there's definitely a lot of items over a small amount of space. Would it be easy to get the things in and out? I mean, obviously, you guys probably took some out to make it a little bit easier to move things around.
It gets easier over time.
Okay.
Also, we think from the photograph that Studley was a tall, slender man with long, skinny fingers. Quite literally, that's part of the equation. Our fingers are a little too meaty for some of these things, and it's a challenge for us to do that. The tool chest was designed by a person who is a fussy, finicky, precise person who did fussy, finicky, precise work. And if you're at all familiar with how piano action are assembled and regulated and adjusted, that is the very definition of somebody who would feel comfortable with this tool cabinet. I personally would not. It's a little too orderly for me. I like a little more chaos in my workspace. But it is amenable to the kind of work that he did.
Gotcha. Now, speaking of the tools themselves, another question came in and was in regards to, is it obvious or are we aware of some of the tools that are in the tool chest? Were they ones that Studley made himself, or was this typically something where he turned to a more specialized tool maker and then just maybe tweaked it himself if necessary?
Well, the specifics of the end of that is we don't know because we weren't there.
That's true.
There are a number of hand-fashioned tools that are exquisite, that were made by the same hand. We can tell from the details. Probably of the tools that were made in their entirety by Studley, it's about 24 of the tools that were modified by Studley. That's another 15 or 20. You know, he had a set of a very nice bench firmer chisels. He took all the handles off and made new handles. They're all graduated just like the chisel is. He made all new nickel-plated brass ferrules for those handles. So there's a lot of his stylistic fingerprints all over this place.
We took pictures of all the tools, you know, for documentation purposes. But we spent a lot of time and attention on the tools that Studley either made himself or modified.
Okay, excellent.
Matt, when you get to see something like his oil stone box,
uh-huh,
your chin will hit the ground.
my chin's like right now, that's why I'm reaching here. I'm not holding my beard. It's actually trying to hold this up, still looking right between the two of you. How many tools exactly are in there? I mean, you just said that you took them out and you photographed them. That had to be quite a feat to get all of those out of there.
Depending on how you count, it's a number between 245 and 250. One of the things that Narayan and I were talking about earlier today, it's like everybody else's toolbox. There's a drawer that's sort of like broken tools and tool pieces and tool parts. So if you count all the broken parts, it's more. But the number we counted up yesterday, and I'm embarrassed to say that I hadn't actually ever counted them all up before. I was too busy studying. The number yesterday was 245.
Gotcha. Now, Ryan, as you were taking these out, did you ever get to that point where you're like, oh man, one more chisel? Do I seriously have to take another picture of another chisel?
No. No. These are the Studley chisels. I mean, if they were Stanley chisels from the Ace Hardware down the street, then yeah, maybe. But no, I mean, we look, some of the tools we photograph to sets, because I don't think there's much photographic interest in a smaller chisel, a slightly larger chisel, a slightly larger mm-hmm. mat. So, you know, we expedited things or treated certain things as groups. But every single one of them we have shot from at least, I think, 6 or 7 angles.
Yeah, pretty much the entire...
It's pretty comprehensive.
The entire cubic surround.
That's right.
We know, another question along the lines of the tools that you found in there. And you just said, like, you know, maybe there was that drawer that you opened and there was, you know, like maybe something that was a little broken or something. What was the condition of the tools themselves? Obviously, it's probably pretty immaculate, but did you find anything that either shocked you about the condition, or maybe even something that you're just like, well, nobody really needs to see this one?
I would have to say, frankly, the thing that shocked me was the good condition of them.
Okay.
I was astounded. You know, all the honed edges are crisp and sharp, and I can tell you that they would still cut you today, or at least I've heard that, that it would still cut you. So the care of them that they received from Studley, and from what we know of the history since Studley owned it, it's basically been an untouched set of tools since. It was a family heirloom. It was on the wall. It was displayed but never used. The tools are all well used and carefully and very sensitively used, but they are well used. There's nothing in there that's just, This is brand new from the store. I'm going to leave it in there and never touch it. Everything has been well used. One of the pleasantly surprising things is, if you were to look, Matt, at your set of chisels and say, okay, which one of these chisels over time is going to become the most worn down? The odds are pretty good. It's the half-inch chisel. You go to his chisel set, he's got 13 of them. The one that's worn down the most, the half-inch chisel.
Oh, really? That's awesome. Yeah, actually, I mine are on the corner of my eye here, and that one has definitely been used the absolute most. That's kind of funny that you're noticing that. but were there any one particular tool or something that kind of stuck out the most from you, other than that half inch one? Is that the answer to that one? That any tool that stuck out the most?
I'll let Narayan take a crack at that first, because my answer is pretty clear for myself. But
I love the oilstone box. And the stone itself, it's not a tool. It's a, you know, it's an object in the chest, and it's unlike any other tool in the chest. It's dirty on the inside, and you know, there's little bits of the oil and slurry on the red velvet.
Yeah.
but you know, in photographing that tool, it's got his inlays. It's got, you can see the marks of his engraving and his name. That's the one that I think I spent the most time on.
I can confirm.
it just seems to be something he cared a lot about. And you know, he obviously cared a lot about the chest,
yeah.
But as for things in the chest, that one is the thing I think got the most attention.
Yeah. For me, it's this mallet right here. I was, one of the things about this week is I was here pretty much by myself for 3 days doing some last minute checking of manuscripts. When you write a manuscript, you always highlight, I need to double check this, or I need to, you know, is this measurement really right, or is it a typo? But I spent basically a full day with that mallet under the microscope looking at it. And I can't wait to get back home, because I'm going to replicate that mallet.
Awesome.
It's a sweet, sweet tool. And I think of it and I see the detail and the attention and the care and say, wow, now that is somebody I'm not sure I'd want to meet. It'd probably drive me crazy. But it's a pretty cool tool.
It's also great for whack-a-mole.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, so now we know what will be Don's big goal afterwards is the mallet. When you can't find him, he'll be working on his mallet, his dream mallet. Well, one last thing I want to ask you is about a question came in regarding who the current owner is of it. But more importantly, what's the future of the Studley Tool Chest? Is there like some sort of foundation or anything set up to make sure that it's well taken care of for generations to come. I know that's one thing that, you know, we see it now. We've talked so much about it. It's so admired. I think one concern from some of the woodworking world is that somehow, and I don't know how it would happen, but somehow it would fall through the cracks and just show up on eBay one day.
It is privately held, and I've been in the artifact world in museums for 40 years, and I have never found a better situation of an artifact and a steward being matched together. This is the right person to own this thing at this time. His family is well committed to caring for it. They will. I think that this is the place it belongs. I personally don't support the concept of government museums, even though I worked in one for almost all of my life. I think the treasure should be in the hands of private people. And he is making it available. I mean, he could have left it here, as Chris said, in his bat cave, but he is giving the public a chance to see it in a very intimate way for 3 days in May. You know, that's how much better can you ask for the caretaking of an iconic object than that?
So that's really awesome to hear. So let's go ahead and remind people once again, when is the event? It's May 15th through 17th, 2015. And if they want to purchase tickets are, I just want to double check, as of right now as we're recording this, tickets are still available for people to show up and be able to get a great glimpse at this?
Sure, tickets are available. You can go to studleytoolchestexhibit.com or even just studleytoolchest.com. We'll jump you to the same site. There's been a fair bit of discussion, you know, in the wood blogosphere to track you there. Tickets are only available on site. On the website, you know, don't send me anything mail-wise. Somebody's asked, you know, can I buy a whole bunch of them, send you a check? Well, no, I don't have any way of processing that. It's set up only to sell on the website. So that's how you do it. And I look forward to seeing people. I will be in the exhibit every minute the exhibit is open. We will have docents there.
I'll be there.
Narayan will be there. We'll be there for people to ask questions. I'll be talking about the collection, the workbench, the tools, the cabinet. Basically, like I said, every hour of the exhibit is only going to have 50 people in it. If you can't get your question in there in that hour, you're not trying.
And as you said, as we had talked about originally in North Carolina, you mentioned that people are going to be able to get really up close. One last thing. Now, it's just in the front. We're not talking like a full 360. You're not going to have people circling this thing. Really?
Circling all around. It will be theater in the round.
Oh, that's amazing. That's going to be fantastic. All right. Well, excellent. Well, thank you guys for giving me the opportunity to have this conversation with you. And of course, to have the two studs in front of the Studley tool chest right there. It looks absolutely amazing. Now, one last thing I want to remind people, they don't have to have the book when it comes out to get into the exhibit, but I have a feeling that it might be a nice little bring along so that you can flip through the pages, maybe have some folks point out what are their favorite photos and how. Noreen, will you be doing any reenactments of getting the photos for individuals if they're interested? Will something like that happen there? Like an interactive exhibit?
No, but we'll have books there too, also for sale. So people who don't have it and are so inspired can get it.
Not one of the things we will have playing in the exhibit hall is video that Moran shot of us putting tools in and taking tools out of the cabinet so people can see that, because I won't be taking anything in or out of the cabinet during the exhibit.
Excellent.
Yeah, that's really the best opportunity to see how all the different panels sort of move in and out and how the tools are sort of layered in ways that you can't get from most photographs.
That's excellent. Well, thank you guys again so much for giving me this opportunity, and I really, really appreciate it, and I look forward to, I'm definitely calling in sick for a few days at the day job so that I can be out there. Hopefully my boss won't see this. So
that's a good thing. It's a good thing you're a video.
Yeah. No, I'm not bringing any cameras. I don't want to mess anything up. Yeah. Excellent. Thank you, guys.
Talk to you later. Bye.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit madsbasementworkshop.com. Also, please consider becoming a patron of Mads Basement Workshop. Get early access to new shows, bonus content from each episode, and so much more. Visit patreon.com/madsbasementworkshop to sign up and start receiving your benefits today.